horrific piece, it's a very disturbing piece, that talks about the co-option of the administration by Wall Street. And when you put all the evidence together, it's a grim picture of an administration that really came in as a reform administration. And it's troubling to many of those of us who supported and who love Barack Obama and see a huge contrast between this president and the last administration. You see that contrast too, in all fairness, correct?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was a big supporter of Barack Obama, and I watched him. I covered him on the campaign trail, and I admired him greatly. You know, I grew to admire him even more during the campaign season. But you know, even before he was elected, I was forced to do a story that noted that he had taken more money from Wall Street in the form of campaign contributions than I think any other two presidential candidates in history, and that, you know, we had written that it wouldn't be surprising if after he got elected that his rhetoric would start to change a little bit and perhaps the personnel would be different too. And that's kind of exactly what happened. You know, he sounded very much like a progressive as a candidate, but as soon as he got elected, like literally that day, he brought in a completely new team. And it was all the money guys, and it was very dispiriting, and I think it accounts for a lot of the sort of schizophrenic posture that the administration has had toward Wall Street since the election.
Well, one of the great sins that you point out in the article is the $306 billion bailout that Citigroup received.
Right, and the really bad part of it was that Citigroup only had to swallow something like the first $29 billion in losses, and everybody knew that there were going to be more losses than that.
Right. The breakdown is that bank gets $20 billion in cash on top of the $25 billion it already received as part of the TARP under the Bush administration.
Right.
And in addition, the government agreed to charge the taxpayers for $277 billion in losses on troubled city assets. And many of those, and this is the conflict that you point out, many of those are toxic assets that Mr. Rubin had
encouraged Citigroup to buy. Right.
Right. And you go on to show how many of Bob Rubin's former proteges from the Clinton year, including New York Fed Chief Geithner,
right,
were intimately involved in the negotiations to save Citibank.
Oh,
obtained high level. He's now Treasury Secretary now, and obtained high level posts in the administration. While the more progressive economists, like Austin Goolsbee, who was an intimate of Barack Obama's during the campaign and was one of the principal, let's say, authors of Obama's thoughts on a new kind of progressive capitalism, and Karen Kornbluh, who served as his foreign policy directors, that they were kind of shipped out to the equivalent of I guess economic Siberia.
Well, in Karen Kornbluh's case, she was literally shipped overseas. She's with the OECD, I think, in Paris. And so she isn't in the picture at all. Goolsbee is really on the Volcker Commission, and let's not forget Volcker as well, who is, you know, is nobody's idea of a liberal, but he was, you know, in terms of regulatory reform, and you know, this is a career public servant who had very definite ideas about the moral hazard of, you know, the bailouts. And Volcker, I think, thought that he was going to have a more pronounced role in this administration, and it turned out that his commission didn't even meet until May. You know, Goolsbee was on that commission. Trumka from the AFL-CIO was another guy. And it was kind of like a catch-all organization where they put everybody who had progressive credentials but who didn't really have any authority in the new administration, where the real power was, you know, on the new economic council, the National Economic Council, excuse me, you know, where Summers and Jason Furman and folks like that, And then they were, again, this is all the Bob Rubin crowd had all the juice in the administration.
You know, I'm heavily involved in the green tech space and have all of these green tech companies that I'm involved with that are, that really are the wave of the future. That last year, green tech provided more new jobs for Americans than all of the Fortune 500 companies combined. So it really wow. is a way out of this depression or this recession, but there's no capital available. And all, you know, these are companies with proven technologies with no risk left that have, that are out in the marketplace doing good things, solar thermal plants and wind farms and battery technologies, but they simply cannot get startup money because right. the financial markets have dried up and there's just no capital available. And I suppose Barack Obama coming in is surrounded by people who are in touch with those aspects of the economy, who understand that, you know, the capital is what, the freeing up of capital is the only thing that's going to heat up the economy again and provide jobs. And we have seen at least some indication in these latest job figures that the strategy may be working. So does that modify your fears about your legitimate and very well documented fears about the path that Obama's taken?
Well, I don't think there's any question that, you know, absent a recovery by Wall Street, the economy was going to be in profound trouble for a long period of time, and I think everybody understood that this was going to be a two-step process, you know, that the very first step was going to have to be to stabilize the capital markets, and that the next step after that was going to be to get the lending flowing again so that, you know, the businesses of the sort that you were talking about could have access to capital. And I think it's indisputable that that needed to be taken care of and you know, that sector of the economy needed to be stabilized. I think the problem is really with the specifics of which people he chose to undertake that mission. And, you know, if you look at the crew that Obama brought in, he brought in an enormous number of people who had connections specifically to Bob Rubin. And Rubin is not just a symbol of Wall Street in general. He has a specific record of having made terrible decisions both in the areas of public policy as Treasury Secretary under Bill Clinton, but also as the executive of a major company in Citigroup. He, in both cases, you know, as Treasury Secretary, pushed through tremendously damaging deregulatory actions, and then as in Citigroup, he urged that company to invest heavily and leverage up and invest in the subprime market. So this is a guy and his minions who have a tremendous amount of responsibility for this specific crisis, and that includes people like Geithner, like Gary Gensler, who now runs the CFTC. Mary Shapiro, while not directly connected to Rubin, who's now the head of the SEC, also has some culpability because you know, she was head of FINRA and helped push through the Commodities Futures Modernization Act that Rubin enacted. So all of these people who are specifically had specific responsibility for that crisis were brought in to run the show again, I think they could have found some different people and still accomplished the mission that you were talking about, you know, without bringing in people who had such a terrible record.
We'll be right back with more on Ring of Fire on Air America Radio.